We tend to talk about the crisis of cities, the needs of cities in the short term. So we thought just for once on a conference like this, we would take a longer view, in fact, roughly a 7,000 year view of what cities have meant and what they may mean in the future. The best person I can think of to do this is Ben Wilson, a historian whose book Metropolis takes us back 7,000 years or so to the first city and walks us through some common themes about cities. Ben, welcome.
Much.
So you talk about sort of common aspects to cities, the density, the spontaneity that produces enormous energies in places like the public baths of Rome or the coffee houses of London or the cafes of Europe, or I guess the street market in Lagos, Nigeria, where they sell computers the way they might have sold fruits. My question is that in the age of COVID, the very attraction of cities, the density, the intermingling of different people became something to be avoided. And we had the tools like Zoom and WhatsApp to do it. Does this mean that the fundamental appeal of cities is now threatened both by possible viruses and by the development of these new virtual ways of communication?
Well, they're excellent questions. And the way I'd answer it, I think, it is to look back at history and what generates our ideas. You talked about going back to the very first city, Uruk, which the product of that density was the beginnings of what we would call civilization, the beginning of the written word, the wheel, bureaucracy, counting systems, a sort of sophistication of the bringing together of ideas into sort of dynamic collision with each other is what cities have always done. They also, something I'm very keen about writing about in my book, is to talk about cities as places of pleasure as well, that we are a social species. Our ideas are generated pretty much in face-to-face contact, and I appreciate that modern technologies are going to challenge that idea. But I think nonetheless, I think cities do have always provided this forum for people to come together. And as you say, we're very good at inventing ways for those to happen, which aren't in the formal areas where you might expect them to happen, like Roman baths were an excellent way of creating mingling, the exchange of ideas in a random, unpredictable, unmanaged kind of way. And I think what I like to sort of see in cities is their ability to create serendipity. Now, that sounds like very nice kind of things, but it's true. And I think, you know, the coffee houses of London, for example, where things that are essential to modern capitalism start, like insurance, the underpinning of modern global trade and capitalism, happened because people are coming together in cafes. So these aren't sort of, you know, airy-fairy or imaginative things. They are things that are deeply implanted in history. And I think we kind of need that more than ever. I think the word that we're using more and more is hybrid, where we will use those technologies. I'm not a Luddite. I'm not wishing them away. But I'm saying that that cities will, as they always have done, evolve to provide some function for communality. Now, cities are unpredictable things. Their evolution is unpredictable. That they have a kind of a durability as well. I think it would take something more severe than COVID to undo the power that they have. And to be frank, a lot worse things have happened to cities. Think of the Black Death in Europe, where many, many more people, where you paid a huge price for density, but the reward was very high, so people kept coming back to cities. And arguably, the Black Death was a massive shift in European culture, economies, and social arrangements, and created new kinds of cities, cities with very different social aspects. Cities have been destroyed by war, they've been destroyed by climate change, by shifting trade patterns. But the idea of cities, the power they have, the fundamental importance they have for our societies never goes away. It changes form. Cities evolve. They're very highly adaptive, complex organisms that will reform and readapt.
We saw here in the United States after World War II a kind of, I would call it an anti-city impulse. Everything from the interstate highway system that let people migrate to the suburbs, to subsidize mortgages. It was kind of a desire to get away from density, to be much more private in our lives. Can cities now develop specific policies that alter that, that become, if I can put it this way, more pro-city in terms of the assets you see as central to city life? Are there specific things that cities can do to plan, if I can use that word, to have a more unplanned kind of urban life?
Well, again, it depends on what kind of cities we want and what functions do we want them to have. I think that, as you say, the anti-city movement from the Second World War probably goes back much further in human history and is deeply rooted in American culture. And it's deeply rooted, it has to be said, in British culture, right? You know, where I come from as well, that we're very good at wanting to run away from cities and to reinvent them and undo their power. And it's very much part of the Judeo-Christian culture as well, to see cities as inauthentic, to see them as sites of sin and danger, disease and vice and immorality. Nonetheless, if we still value what is great about cities, what we enjoy about them, then we should think very clearly about why we want them to exist in the first place, why density is a good idea. And I would suggest that several reasons why they are a good idea. One is because of a reaction against the technologies that we're talking about, and that affects people at particular times in their life cycle, which is when you do need to be around people and ideas need to be exchanged in a face-to-face kind of way. So cities should think very carefully about attracting those kinds of people at that particular time in their life cycle before they do what people have done throughout history, which is to do a runner from the cities, which I think is a feature of attention in city life. Another way to make cities more attractive and more affordable. One of the things that kills cities is their sheer unaffordability for people at that time in their life when they need it most, which is when they're younger, is to make cities more affordable. And that is connected with density, quite frankly. The cities do need to find ways to be more dense. But at the same time, one of the biggest movements in global city building for far-sighted cities is to think very carefully about their physical environment and to bring in more greenery, more open spaces, and to do something which has been seen as impossible throughout history, this idea that there's a divide between country and city. That if you go to Dutch cities, for example, which I go to quite a lot and greatly admire as places of kind of culture, ideas, but also sort of forward thinking in environmental terms, is that there is a much more a wilder side to cities, to make rivers cleaner, to bring in, forget formal parks, to think about wildness in cities. And cities are very, very productive ecosystems if we let them. There's lots of marginal spaces in cities. So to make cities more attractive in that way, to satisfy, you know, what we have, which is a craving for nature, there are plenty of cities, you know, around the world where nature is coming in a much, much bigger way. You know, London is on its way to become a national park in the UK, which is quite an incredible thing.
I'm glad you cited that, because the city that I grew up in, New York, now has a park that connects the city to the Hudson River in a way it never did when I was growing up. You can take kayaking trips on the Hudson River. Yeah. The movement to get cars out of the central city, which is hugely politically controversial, but with congestion pricing. So are these the kinds of things that cities can do? For instance, taking apart highways that have divided neighborhoods in the past and putting them back together. Is this the kind of thinking you think is critical to making cities more like cities?
It is absolutely critical. I think, you know, what part of that sort of anti-city movement was to sort of hollow out cities in a way, partly through by highways, by cars, all those things which kind of go against the joys of city life, which are its street life. As you say, the kind of that opening up of the city, the softening of the hard edge of the city to bring in nature, which, you know, it is an anti-car thing in a way. It's a luxury of the post-industrial city. But so we should look at a post-car city if we can, because the car was the thing that kind of undid that sort of sociability of cities, the connected neighbourhoods, the rootedness in communities was completely undone by these modes of transport that come in the 20th century and completely kind of rip up cities and do incredible damage to them, and damage which is reversible. Britain has done enormous damage to its smaller cities. I think London's very lovely. There's the cities that are reviving, such as Manchester and Newcastle. But those sort of smaller towns are completely scarred by the kind of the tyranny of the motor car, which does, you know, affect the flow of pedestrian traffic. Again, go back to the question, who are cities for? What is the soul of the city? What makes them pleasurable places to be? And it is that street life, and it is that sort of, connection to the assets of the city, whether they're liquid assets in the form of rivers and shorelines, or to, areas of kind of wilderness and leftover spaces in cities, all of which will make them much more attractive. And that's, in an age where we feel we can do without cities, we need to keep faith in cities and go back to those ideas we talked about at the very beginning, the bathhouses, the souk, the marketplace, the theatre, all those places that kind of that encourage sociability, mixing, the kind of the sensuous thing about cities, to see them less as kind of places of wealth and utilitarian purposes, but to see them as places of pleasure. And that is the building block for productivity as well.
One of the problems I think that we have in the United States is this country was founded to some extent by people that didn't like cities. And Jefferson, if I remember right, thought them centers of pestilence and corruption. We wanted an agricultural country where the yeoman farmer was the centerpiece. So it seems to me that it takes some doing politically to create an environment where there's a pro-city sense of what we want to do.
Yeah, and as I said before, I don't think cities are for everyone, and they're not for everyone at all times in their life. But we still like to access cities, whether we're suburban or not. I think we need to get realistic about how much more land there is available to kind of constantly spread out. There's a conflict across the world between city and nature, in the sense of cities expanding into areas. There is a kind of value in density, from the point of view of sustainability, to undo that kind of perception of cities as something that you're constantly running away from. Well, that does take a lot of investment, and it does, part of the, you get into a very negative sort of spiral of taking investment away from cities, taking away your public transport networks and things like that, the things that sort of the things that glue cities together, the kind of the sinews that sort of keep the city running. And that is really about, changing that perception of cities, making them welcoming, innovative places, constantly innovative. And I think the 20th century was marked by a kind of, collapsing belief in the ideals of city life. And I think that is prevalent in America. I think it's less so in Europe, in continental Europe, certainly, where cities were kept alive. And go back to what we're talking about, the car. I think the street life of cities is a very compelling thing. It's where we go to watch the sort of the theatre of the world kind of unfolded before us, and we like that. We like to be part of cities, but we like to get away from cities as well. So I think keeping them attractive for people who want to use them and live in them and inhabit them. I'm not for corralling people into cities or making them live there. But I think the kind of the urban ideal is kind of good for it. That sort of idea of sociability, walkability is good for our mental and our physical health. So cities can do an awful lot of good for us.
Last question. You're talking at this conference to people whose goal is to rebuild cities. That's the whole notion of this conference. So give these people one piece of guidance as to what they should be thinking about and doing to make cities flourish in the way that you've come to. You've described them as humankind's greatest invention. How do we keep that invention going? So it's your floor. Have at it.
Well, I'm a historian, so I'm going to answer this as a historian and say the purpose of my book, I think, in an age where we have lost faith in cities a bit, I think my book is partly a reminder of the things that made cities hum, the things that we might have lost through things like you say with the car, with the increasing pricing out of people from cities. That sort of vitality, the sensuous, fun aspect of cities comes from history. It is a reminder that although we, cities can fall, they can lose their sheen, there are things that we can do, damage that we can reverse. So I would not you know, you don't have to read my book. You can read a book about Constantinople. You can read a book about Damascus or Baghdad or Hong Kong, whatever you want to read. There are great stories about cities, stories that we must remind ourselves and constantly tell ourselves, not to kind of get trapped in an idea of what a city is now, but what the possibilities, the pleasures, the dynamism of cities exist in our past. And they can also, as much as we need to look to the future, not denying that, but as much as we want to kind of keep alive that idea of cities, look to that vitality, that sort of pulsing kind of, you know, great kind of stories and anecdotes, art, cinema. They're the resources that we need to dig into, to look at those lives of the texture of real people living in cities, so that we don't forget what we're in real danger of losing.
Ben Wilson, I'm taking the next flight back to New York City. You've convinced me. And thank you very much for joining us. Much appreciate your time.
Huge pleasure. Thank you very much. Okay.